Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Wonderful to have all of you here. Morning in Hong Kong, but since we have members from around the world, good evening, good afternoon. We are very, very honored to have Professor Michael McFaul from Stanford University being with us here today. I think you all know him. That's why you joined this meeting. This is, we have two kinds of members, participants right here. Anybody can join. You're welcome on Facebook, on YouTube. But on the other hand, we also have a lot of our what we call President Circle members, corporate members of the Asia Society being here with us. Let me just give you one or two housekeeping things first. In case you have questions from the anytime you want, you can start typing onto the chat function of the Zoom. That's number one. Number two, this is an open program until 10 o'clock. We'll see what happened then. I just also want to announce, in case anyone interested, several programs of the Asia Society. On November 3rd, we're going to have a program on China-Japan relationship with Jesper Kohl and the chairman of our Japan Center of the Asia Society, James Kondo. It will be wonderful. On November 5th, Dr. Shan Wei Jian, who just wrote the book Out of Gobi, and then he wrote another book on his experience buying a Korean bank by an American PC firm. And it was a really interesting story. So that is his latest book. He's going to talk about it on November 5th. And then on November 17th is the virtual dinner of the Asia Society Hong Kong celebrating our 30th anniversary. If you're interested, just ask offline any of us from the Asia Society. Well, back to Professor Mike McFaul. Wonderful to have you. Let me just say one or two things. Number one, you are probably still the only U.S. ambassador to Russia who is not a diplomatic corps person. So that's number one. Number two, I think, are you allowed into Russia today, Mike?
Maybe. No, I'm not. No, I'm right. Now a persona non grata, yes.
Right. So you're the only one that I know of. That's very interesting news. And then I, of course.
No, there's one more. There's one more. I want to interrupt. There's anytime. One other ambassador who has been on the list. His name was George Kennan.
Oh, okay.
So I'm in good company.
Yeah, in good company. You're right. And then finally, my first question and maybe last question to Mike is when are you moving to Washington, D.C.? But I will leave it answer to the end, okay?
Okay.
Anyway, Mike, we are all very interested in your view, not just about Russia, but also about the great powers that are in play today. In particular, unfortunately, in most of our opinions, it's to the worse. So how do you see America's diplomacy today, and America being the strongest and the most powerful country in the world? Whatever they do, it's going to affect everything in the world almost. And so tell us about your thoughts about U.S. In its foreign relations, Russia, as well as China. So we will begin by asking Professor McFaul to say a few words, 15, 20 minutes perhaps, and then we will have a dialogue, and then we'll open to the floor. So, but anytime, ladies and gentlemen, on this call, please feel free to type in your question now. Professor McFaul, it's yours.
Well, Ronnie, thanks for having me. Good to see you again. I wish I was in Hong Kong with you personally. And you guys have a great place and a great facility there. I know I've spoken there before. I hope to get back someday. I'm going to use some slides because I'm Professor McFaul today, and I'm going to be speaking historically and analytically and less about politics, although I'm happy to answer any questions when we get to that. For those that want to know my views about President Trump's foreign policy, I actually just published a piece in the Washington Post yesterday where I gave him grades as a good professor on climate change, U.S. policy towards China, Russia, the Middle East. And so please look up that piece and you'll see I'm a pretty tough grader. His final grade for that exam was a D-. But what I want to do today, and let me say two other things by way of caveats. I'm obviously speaking in my personal capacity today. I worked with Vice President Biden for 3 years at the White House before going to Moscow for 2 years. I know the Vice President well. I know his team well. I'm happy to answer questions, but I'm here just speaking as a professor from Stanford University. And the last caveat I want to say, my talk tonight is going to be about great power competition, United States, China, and Russia. But I want to say at the outset, I feel very nervous in this crowd talking about China. I am not a China expert. I've spent two of the last four summers living and doing research in Beijing at Beida. Stanford has a campus there, as some of you know. But I in no means am an expert, and I want to ask you to help me to get more expert about what I am saying here, historically and analytically, trying to compare this triangular relationship. So with that modest caveat in mind, let me now bring up some slides if I can. And therefore you can look at something and not have to look at me. Can everybody see that? Did that come up okay?
Yep, got it.
Excellent. So this is what I'm going to talk about, this triangular relationship. I think it's very striking in my country, and I want to keep emphasizing, I'm going to speak as an American looking at this relationship. And this is a talk, by the way, that it's the same talk I give in Washington or Stanford or with Russians or Chinese, and this is my first time doing it in Hong Kong, but it's the same exact talk. I'm not changing anything whatsoever. And if you follow great power politics, I think everybody will agree that there's been a lot of talk about a return to the Cold War. Most certainly you see this with Russia. Russians say that. Dmitry Medvedev says it. The President of the United States says it. Lots of books have been written about the new Cold War. In parallel, a little bit later, but in parallel, you see the same thing happening now, at least for my country, talking about U.S.-China relations. And in particular, I would say this summer, you had a series of speeches by the Trump administration where they very explicitly echoed the fact that, in their view, that we are returning to a new Cold War with China. The National Security Advisor, Mr. O'Brien, even comparing Xi Jinping very directly to Stalin, a comparison, by the way, that I disagreed with and wrote about in Foreign Affairs over the summer. But without question, this debate is happening in Washington about are we entering a new Cold War with China? So tonight, what I want to do is I want to talk about how did we go from that period of the end of the Cold War, which I thought was a glorious moment in the history of U.S. Relations with the rest of the world. That's a photo of Reagan and Gorbachev there on the left, to our current moment today, these conflictual relationships that we have now with Russia and with China. And just so you know, I was at the meeting of that's Mr. President Obama and Putin meeting in Los Cabos, Mexico in 2012. That meeting was a lot worse than that photo. So first, I want to explain from my perspective how we went from the end of the Cold War and the end of history 30 years ago to these new confrontational moments. Second, I want to compare and contrast the actual Cold War with these alleged new Cold Wars with Russia and China. Some things I think are similar and some things are different. And then if we have time, I'll speculate a little bit about how I think the United States should approach both China and Russia. All right, so what happened? I think there are three factors that we need to look at. Not just one. And I think analysts and policymakers make a mistake if they just look at one of these factors. I think all three of them are important to understand and to explain what happened. First, let's talk about power. Without question, the most important event in the last 30 years has been the significant increase in power that China now has compared to 30 years ago. But second, I think Russia has also become more powerful. I think that's frequently misunderstood. Most certainly in Beijing, that's misunderstood. And most certainly in Washington, it's misunderstood. And then third, there's been a relative decline of American power. And if you're interested in going in deeper in that, I have many, many slides to to do the compare and contrast about the balance of power in the international system that's changed. But that's a necessary variable, but I don't think it explains everything. I think you have to add two more. One is regime type. And here, I think there's been continuity in regime type with respect to China. There's been ups and downs, but a fairly same regime type 30 years ago that you had compared to today. I think where the radical changes happen is in Russia. Russia did have a weak democratic system in the 1990s. That system has now been transformed, and it is an autocratic regime today. And then third, I think we need to say, honestly, that the United States as a regime type is also changed. We are no longer as robust of a democracy as we were 30 years ago. I think by Freedom House ranks us about 25th or so these days. And likewise, I think, and this is a deeper debate, but I think especially in the COVID era, but I would even argue before, we've seen a decline in American state capacity as a regime. That is something we were not debating 30 years ago. And then finally, this I think it's frequently missed in academic circles in America. I don't know about Hong Kong, but I do know in America, if we're debating these things at Harvard or Stanford or Princeton or UC Berkeley, academics tend to play down the roles of leaders. I think they're quite important. And I think to ignore leaders with all other things being equal, balance of power and regime type being equal, does not give you the full picture. And here, I would just note that Putin, as a leader, has changed that where Russia has gone in a radical way. He's become much more aggressive, invading Ukraine, supporting a dictator, Mr. Assad, in 2015, violating our sovereignty in 2016 during the elections, and literally trying to kill a former spy in the UK in 2018. Those are very radical, belligerent, revisionist actions that another Russian leader with the same political system and the same power might have behaved differently. Most certainly, I think President Medvedev would have behaved differently, let alone somebody like Boris Nemtsov, who was chosen, was the heir apparent to be the next leader of Russia way back in 1997 and 98 until Boris Yeltsin changed his mind. And by the way, I consider Putin to be the most revisionist leader in the world today of the great powers. Compared to Xi Jinping, for instance, President Xi is doing none of these kinds of activities around the world. And I think that's an important distinction to make. But I do think that the change in leadership in China back in 2012 has had a causal impact on the way that China is behaving in the world. And I think a different leader in power in Beijing today might have taken China in a different direction. And third, I believe the same about my country. I believe that President Trump has had an independent causal impact. That's an academic, the way we would talk in academia, that is important irrespective of the balance of power that the United States has, irrespective of the regime type that we have in the United States. And I think he has been radical in his isolationist policies, his realist policies, and his nationalist policies in a way that you would not have had, for instance, Jeb Bush become president, even though he's a Republican in a democratic society with the same power. In fact, I would say he is much more extreme than all of the other Republican candidates that were on the ballot trying to become president back in 2016. I call it the Trump withdrawal doctrine, where he's withdrawn from the world. And I think that has had a profound impact on the balance of power between Russia, China, and the United States. So briefly, similarities and differences between the Cold War. My general reaction is that we overuse this metaphor. I actually think the differences in U.S.-Russian relations are more important today than the comparisons with the Cold War. I especially believe that with respect to U.S.-China relations. I think we tend to overplay this metaphor. I think the differences are more important. But if you go through the list, and don't be afraid of these next slides, I'm not going to go through them in detail. That would take all the rest of our time. But I am in the camp that there are some similarities and there are some differences. It's not one or the other. Let me just highlight three to try to illustrate why one or the other is too simplified. I'll do this as good news, bad news. Let me start with Russia and the comparison between the Cold War and what I like to call the hot peace. That was the title of my last book, From Cold War to Hot Peace. I'm now writing a new book on China, by the way. I'll say more of that about that maybe in questions. So good news, bad news. The good news is that today we are not in a quantitative nuclear arms race with Russia. That's over. We're now capped at 1,550 nuclear weapons. By the way, you can still blow up the world with 1,500 weapons. We have a long ways to go, but we're not at 30 or 40,000 like we were during the peak of the Cold War. The bad news is that we have a qualitative arms race. Russia in particular has developed some new weapons that I think are highly destabilizing. The Poseidon in particular, which is a nuclear powered torpedo that is designed to go to the West Coast and the East Coast of the United States. I live on the West Coast, and explode and then flood the entire state of California during in places like the Bay Area. That's highly destabilizing. That's not a weapon we had during the Cold War. Ideology, good news. The battle between communism and capitalism is over. Don't believe Donald Trump when he tells you we're back to a fight between communism and capitalism. That's not true. That's good news. The bad news is that there is a new ideological struggle between Putinism, which is a kind of orthodox conservative nationalism, and what he calls the decadent Western liberalism. And that ideological struggle is taking place within countries, especially in Europe and my country, the United States, between conservative nationalists and Western liberals. And Putin is starting to win. He's winning in Hungary. His ideas are winning in Italy. And in some circles in my country, his ideas are on the ascendancy. So that's very troubling to me. And then finally, good news, bad news. The good news that has ended from the Cold War is that we are not fighting proxy wars all over the planet like we did during the Cold War. Remember everybody, the Cold War wasn't cold. 20 million people died in places like Korea, Vietnam, Afghanistan, Angola, 20 million people. Thank goodness we're not doing that with respect to Russia today. The bad news is that some of the new instruments of competition are highly destabilizing, and we didn't have them in the Cold War. Annexation. We didn't have annexation in the Cold War. It's back after Putin annexed Crimea in 2014. In 2016, in my country, we witnessed a new weapon of competition, the violation of our sovereignty during our presidential election. That is something we did not have during the Cold War. China, very briefly. Here, there are similarities and differences. A couple of similarities. I think the world is moving towards bipolarity. We're not there yet, but we're moving that way. China is rising. The United States is rising. China is rising faster, but we are still rising. Do not ever forget that. We are still becoming more powerful compared to the rest. China is just rising at a faster rate. That is creating a system towards bipolarity that's like the Cold War. Second, that is a global competition that's like the Cold War. Third, there's an ideological competition between democracy and autocracy that is also like the Cold War. And fourth, there is a propagation of those ideas. America propagates our ideas around the world. China does as well. That's another dimension that's like the Cold War. However, I think the differences are much bigger. And again, I won't go through this complicated slide in detail, although I'm happy to go back in questions. But three or four, I think, are very important to remember. Number one, it's bipolar, but it is not equal balance of power. On military power, on economic power, on educational power, on alliances. The United States, on all of those dimensions, is still outranks China in terms of a comparison of power. And it will take China a long time to catch up to the United States on many of those dimensions of power. The one that's closest, of course, is economic power, which you all know better than I do. But when you look at gross domestic product or PPP, the gap is closing. But when you look at GDP per capita, the gap is really large and probably will not close until the end of this century. So that dimension is different. Second, the ideological contest is different. And this is probably my biggest disagreement with my friends in the Trump administration. It is not like the Soviet Union propagation of Marxism, Leninism around the world. I think it is a shadow of that. And I think we will make some big mistakes if we think it's just like the Soviet ideological contest. Third, our economies are much more intertwined than the Soviet and American economies were during the Cold War. That creates opportunities, but also challenges. Fourth, we are not fighting proxy wars around the world, and I hope we do not fall into that. And then this last one is very important. The United States is pulling back at this moment in the 21st century. That was not true during the Cold War. Throughout the entire Cold War, Americans in the Republican Party and Democratic Party thought we had to lead the free world. That is now a contested idea, most certainly in the Republican Party, but it's also a contested idea in the Democratic Party. That is a radical difference between U.S.-China competition today and U.S.-Soviet competition during the Cold War. So finally, maybe I'll end on this. I won't talk about prescriptions. Things that worry me about the overuse of this metaphor. In fact, this, I think, is a better slide to show you what I'm worried about. Because I've talked too long. I want to get to your questions. The lessons I take from the Cold War, and these are lessons, I think, for policymakers in Beijing, Moscow, and Washington, not just for the United States. Number one is threat misperceptions. We made some huge mistakes during the Cold War by overestimating the threat from the Soviets. The missile gap in the 60s, McCarthyism in the 1950s, believing that everybody looking for communists within our country. And of course, the biggest one was our misperception of blending nationalism and communism in Vietnam that led us into a tragic, horrific war that we did not have to fight in order to win the Cold War. I think the biggest threat misperception that the Soviets had was believing that evolutionary political change in Hungary or Czechoslovakia or Poland would somehow threaten regime stability in the Soviet Union. And their overreaction to that political evolution, I think, was costly for them. Second, overreach. We overreached in places like Angola and Nicaragua that were costly to us. The Soviets overreached in Afghanistan. That, I think, is a really important lesson for Vladimir Putin in places like Ukraine. And I think it is an important lesson for leaders in Beijing about the cost of overreach when you think you are all powerful. Third, we made a big mistake in believing in good dictators during the Cold War. And there are some, particularly in the Trump administration, that are making this mistake again. And I think we need to be very careful about that. And then fourth, this is a lesson that I think is important for both Moscow and Beijing. I spend a lot of time talking to Chinese colleagues about lessons from the Cold War, and they all love to talk about the 80s and the giant mistakes that Gorbachev made. They don't spend enough time studying the 70s. The 70s was a time when the Soviet Union caught up to us in terms of the balance of power and nuclear weapons and conventional war. And we were at a very unstable period, the 60s and 70s, in terms of the United States. But that led to adventurism, I would say, with Leonid Brezhnev believing that the correlation of forces were on their side. And it led to a big neglect of domestic economic policy inside the Soviet Union. They have a word for it. Zastoy is the word in Russian. And that created the real crisis consequences for the Soviet Union in the 1980s. And I see that happening again in Russia today under Vladimir Putin, where he's not spending enough time trying to focus on problems at home. He's spending times invading his neighbors. And that is a very dangerous cocktail, where you neglect reform, and as particularly economic reform at home, and you spend too much time talking about exporting your power abroad. Those were the conditions that led to the collapse of the Soviet Union. And I hope my country as well, we need to study those. But there are also, and I'll end on this, important lessons to emulate from the Cold War so that we avoid catastrophic events, including, God forbid, war between China and the United States, or war between the United States and Russia. And here I would just group them in two categories. We learned how to cooperate and confront the Soviets at the same time, and cooperated on some really big important things. Smallpox eradication, non-proliferation treaty, arms control, space. We did those together. I don't see us doing enough of that with either Russia or China today. And second, we learned how to do some crisis prevention and crisis management that we're not doing enough, in my opinion, with either China or Russia today. And that leads to misperceptions between capitals that can lead to dangerous conflicts. And I am really frightened by how little interaction there are between my government and the governments of China and the governments of Russia today. And then finally, I just want to remind everybody, last thing, if you believe that leaders matter, like I do, then I want to just remind you that most certainly in my country, leadership change again could lead to very different kinds of relations very quickly, and that we are not locked in to these Cold War confrontations that currently dominate the political debate in my country. And with that, I think I'll skip this, and I'll skip all this for now, and just let's go to more conversation. Thanks for being so patient, and I'm really ready. Don't bet against America yet. And for a deeper dive, please buy my book. Okay. All right. Thank you all. I'm going to take these slides down and now answer your questions with Ronnie. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Mike. This is superb. Very well presented. Thank you. I also want to take this opportunity to thank Charlie Xi, your friend and my friend, who really gave me the idea to start with, a big supporter of the Asian side in Hong Kong. Thank you, Charlie. Let me ask you a couple of questions on Russia first, Mike. Russia has a very weak economy. It's really a single industry economy. And that's how Reagan on the United States defeated Russia, Soviet Union. And what about today? You're right, Russia still have a tremendous amount of new weapons, but economy, can it be the Achilles heel to Russia and be defeated, so to speak, again?
Great question, Ronnie. So two things I'll say, and I want to make sure they don't sound contradictory, because they're not in my head. So the first thing, in my country, here in the United States, people have a memory of the Soviet Union collapsing and people out on the streets begging and selling fish in their socks from the 90s, because Russia did endure an economic collapse, an economic depression that was three times as worse as the economic depression that the United States endured in the 1930s. That is true. That happened. But Russia also has recovered from that economic collapse. So Russia today is not begging. Russia today has recovered from that. And they had a period of growth for the first 10 years of the Putin era that was about 7% GDP per capita. That was one of the best emerging economies in the world. Nothing like China, of course, but they did recover. And they had an industrial base and a scientific base that recovered as well. And I think that's important for people to remember. You know, they are one of the most educated countries in the world. They continue to produce more PhDs in math and physics than I think they're still ahead of the United States on that, right? So, and then GDP per capita, they are also a relatively wealthy society. They're most certainly more wealthy than China is today. GDP per capita. GDP per capita. I want to keep stressing that. Not GDP total, but per capita. I think they're 50th. I can find it. I have it in my notes here. I'll look it up. I think they're 44th or so, whereas China is 72nd or something like that. But to your point, they realized, and here I would say President Medvedev in particular, when he took over in 2008, he realized that Russia was too dependent on oil and gas, and that they had to make investments. They had to do transfer of wealth from the oil and gas sector to subsidize the high-tech sector, to subsidize companies in the high-tech sector. And if you go back and you read some of the things that he was aspiring to do, they were actually trying to learn from China, by the way. From the United States as well, but especially China, how you transfer wealth from the state-owned economy and help create the permissive conditions for the high-tech firms to emerge. In fact, they even created something called Skolkovo, which was their really rough equivalent of the Silicon Valley, where the government was subsidizing Russian companies and American companies, by the way, American high-tech companies to invest in Skolkovo. Some of the companies I know well here in the Valley moved to Skolkovo and opened operations to do that. And I think that was wise, by the way. I think that was smart to try to take advantage of Russian brains as opposed to Russian resources. Putin has closed that down. Putin, since 2012, I mean, Skolkovo still exists, but Putin got scared of the private sector. He decided that individual investors and individual entrepreneurs were threatening his base of power. And he put the brakes on that. And he became more nervous about foreign investment as well, especially, by the way, in high-tech sectors. And so what has happened is, you know, they've gone back to Zastoy. They've gone back to that period, that Brezhnev period, where they're living off the revenues of oil and gas. And I think in the long term, it's not sustainable. And that the one of the real tragedies that you've seen has happened is the smartest people from Russia, the best and the brightest, have emigrated. You know, the second or third largest immigrant community now where I live here in the Silicon Valley are Russians. Chinese, Indians, and Russians are the three main groups of immigrants that are here in the Silicon Valley working in the high-tech companies. It's about 80,000 people now. And those are 80,000 of the best and brightest that had Russia created the more permissive conditions for them to stay. They would have rather stayed in Russia.
Well, Mike, America is very, I don't want to be distracted from Russia yet. Is America not more worried about them?
Well, the first thing I'll say is, as an American citizen who teaches at Stanford University with many students of Chinese descent, including my own son. I have two sons, and they are both a quarter Chinese. Their grandmother immigrated from Guangzhou to the United States. They're proud of their heritage, by the way. They both study Mandarin these days. They've both been to Hong Kong. In fact, I'll just tell a little anecdote. One of my sons just turned 18 yesterday, and we had this fantastic feast, and he said something to the effect of, "This is one of the best meals I've ever had, and now I'm going to forget the name of it. since we had tea cakes at the train station in Hong Kong, and now I'm going to forget the place where they have Cha Siu Bao that he loves, and I'm forgetting that it's a chain that you have. I'm forgetting the name of it. Where they literally had like 21 dishes. They went crazy because they love that. You know, we have a tradition after church. We always go to have tea cakes here in Palo Alto. But at that Hong Kong place, I'll remember the name of it in a minute. We literally were just talking about it yesterday. But I'm sorry to get off on that. I am outraged. I am completely outraged by these racist comments by my fellow citizens that are completely ignorant and that are happening to people like you say, that are some people, you know, on my faculty here that are being insulted on the streets who have been here for literally 100 years. It is outrageous. It really deeply troubles me because I know, I didn't live through it, but I am an expert and I know what McCarthyism did to our country back in the 50s. I think it's outrageous. And I also want to say that I think it's also outrageous students from Hong Kong that we have here at Stanford, students from Beijing, students from Shanghai, those students need to be treated with respect as well. We are an open society. And if we start trying to say we're going to teach one curriculum for Americans and we're going to teach another curriculum for people from Russia or China or France or Germany, for that matter, that will be the end of our great university. So I believe that really strongly. And if the government, of the United States thinks that a country is using students for espionage purposes, as has been alleged, that it's their job to fight espionage. It is not my job as a professor at Stanford to do that. And I think they should do that before we allow alleged spies to come into our country. But that if we start policing ourselves, that will be the end of great institutions like Stanford. Now, to your point, there is a great deal of concern about intellectual theft, and there, you know, we should use the right proper channels of the U.S. government to fight that. I support that, but we cannot discriminate people based on the way they look or the color of their passport. I think that is a bridge to nowhere. With respect to Russians, just so you know, the U.S. government does watch what Russian government officials do here in our country as well. And I don't think it was an accident that when there was a tit-for-tat battle between Russia and the United States, that the Trump administration chose to close the Russian consulate in San Francisco. And what they said when they did that, remember, they closed the Chinese consulate in Hong Kong. But they closed the Russian consulate in San Francisco because the allegation was, I don't know, because it's secret information, of course, but the allegation was that that consulate was being used for espionage primarily here in the Silicon Valley.
I thought that every consulate does espionage, whichever country. So is it a matter of principle that you cannot allow that? If that's the case, then everybody does it. So you should stop it. All consulates. Or is it maybe they're just so good, they're getting so close that the United States go against diplomatic principles and block it?
It's a great question, Ronnie. I don't know the answer to your question. I do because of the technological dimension of it, all of which is classified. I mean, I used to know more about this when I was in the government. I don't know the answer to that. I do know, however, as a former diplomat, that I strongly believe we shoot ourselves in the foot when we get in these tit-for-tat arguments about closing consulates. That does not serve. Yeah, I do not believe that that serves American national interests. That's my personal view. I believe, as an American, who we are in a very troubled time in my country. I want to be clear about that. The most troubling time we've ever been in terms of a democratic society. I'm deeply alarmed by the level of polarization we have in my country. I'm deeply alarmed by some of the statements that President Trump has made with respect to respecting the democratic process after a free and fair election. And having said all that, I also believe that one of the strongest things we have as a country is our soft power, is our public diplomacy, is our people, is our companies, is our universities. And so when I was the U.S. ambassador to Russia, I always, I wanted the more Americans we could to get out to the cities of Russia to come, because I knew that that interaction with Americans was going to help us. And likewise, I wanted more Russians to go. My home state is Montana. I wanted those Russians to go to the hinterland and to go to see Montana and Wyoming and Idaho, because I knew that spending time in America was going to be our best way to change their views that they might be seeing on television, Russian television. And when we stop those kinds of people-to-people dialogues, I think that hurts America more than it hurts any other country.
Mike, let's talk about our children. You have two sons. I have two sons. I'm pretty sure that your sons are partly because of their one quarter Chinese, they will be more superior to Mike because they will be able to eat char siu bao better than you can. However, now to my sons. I have a son who used to teach in the other great California private university in Southern California, and you scared the heck out of me. I mean, Russians can attack California. Now, Chinese doesn't have those weapons, as far as I can tell. So why is America not afraid, more afraid of the Russians than the Chinese? Why is it so China, awful, fearful? Of course, I know economics is one, but technology. I mean, if you cannot turn the technology into weapons like the Russians can, then, China perhaps is not as scary as the Russians. Why is Washington, D.C. not more against Russia?
Well, Washington's actually deeply divided about which should be the threat. And if you look at Pew poll data, just came out recently, you'll see that if you're a Republican, you tend to believe that the China threat is the greatest threat to the United States. Democrats believe that climate change is the greatest threat to the United States. And so we're actually quite divided on threat perceptions because of politics. That's number one. Number two, there is a very conscious political effort on behalf of President Trump and his campaign to emphasize the China threat. By the way, he's not the first politician to do this. Let's be clear. You may remember even, Bill Clinton tried to elevate the China threat going all the way back to 1992. But it is most certainly part of this moment in history that President Trump is trying to elevate the China threat, partly, Ronnie, because he doesn't want us to talk about Russia. Because Vice President Biden is constantly talking about the Russian threat, and in particular, the intelligence on this is very clear. The Russian intervention on social media is much higher in our election right now than anything any other country is doing. And so President Trump wants to divert from that. And that's why he's always talking about China. Third thing I would say, with respect to nuclear weapons and existential threats, there's no comparison. Russia still is the main threat. China has 250 nuclear weapons. Russia has thousands. That there's a giant gap there, and we, in my opinion, have to remain focused on Russia first and foremost. That's why I think it's very important that we extend the New START treaty, for instance. And at the same time, there's no doubt that China's military power, China's cyber power, on many other dimensions of power, space. China is also a rising power, and managing the rise of Chinese military power is the most important, I would say, a foreign policy challenge of the United States for the rest of this century. Now I would say the last thing. I also believe that there is a negative consequence to over-exaggerating that threat. And that is a lesson I think we need to learn from the Cold War. We believed, if you go back, I'm writing about it right now, we had a debate in the beginning of the Cold War. And I invoked George Kennan already, so let me invoke him again. Kennan was the author of the containment strategy, right? Everybody knows that well. What a lot of people don't know is that Kennan was against global containment everywhere.
Correct.
He believed that we had to have a more moderate strategy of containment. And he lost that debate to a guy named Dean Acheson, who thought that we had to go and anywhere we saw a communist, we had to go and try to stop them. And it was that mentality that got us into Vietnam. It was that mentality that had us supporting horrible people like Jonas Savimbi in Angola, because we thought that we had to stop communism in Angola, because if we didn't stop communism in Angola, you know, the Angolans were going to come all the way to America and we're going to have communism in America. That was a hugely flawed strategy. And I worry about that sometimes with some of the debate, particularly in Washington, about the Chinese threat. Some of it is real, and we need to contain it. I firmly believe that. We need to have a robust containment strategy. But not everything that China does everywhere around the world should be viewed as export of Marxism-Leninism. And not every move around the world should be viewed as a threat to the United States. And if we try to stop everything that China does around the world, that actually, ironically, could make America weaker.
Very good, Mike. And ladies and gentlemen, actually, some of these questions I'm asking, I'm incorporating your questions from the audience who are raised their hand in my computer. So I'm just going to go on. Some of them are my question. Most of them are your question. Okay, Mike, U.S.-China relationship is terrible. How does Russia look at it? How are they taking advantage of it?
Yeah, great question.
From the floor.
Putin loves it. Putin loves it. He loves it. This is exactly what they want. Because for two reasons. One, it means we're focused on China, not Russia. And it means we're focused on, you know, Asia and not Europe, right? So in my view, we have a lot of work to do to strengthen NATO, but we're not focused on Europe right now. We're focused on Asia. So Putin loves that. But here's the bigger thing. Putin's somewhat frustrated because he wants China to become more of a revisionist power like he is. He wants Xi Jinping to say, we're done with the liberal institutional order. We want to go it alone. And he's pulling the Chinese to do that. And, you know, when I was ambassador, you know, this is several years ago, he was failing at that. Remember, he was failing at that. When he annexed Crimea, China did not support him in that. They said, hey, no, we don't believe in annexation. We think annexation is dangerous. And that was really interesting. I remember that very vividly. He was very frustrated by that. Like, we're allies after all. You should be supporting us on that. WTO, you know, the liberal institutions and even things like AIB, by the way, that's part of playing within the rules of the game of the international system. Putin doesn't benefit that much from that because of the conversation we had earlier, right? He doesn't need the WTO as much as countries like China does. So he's very happy to see them collapse. but he's been frustrated that China has not moved as fast in that direction as he would like. But now, as tensions between China and the United States are growing, he's more hopeful that, you know, you'll have this axis of illiberal countries coming together. So the more China and the United States fight, the better it is for Vladimir Putin.
Another question from the floor. What is Russia's game or end game in the Middle East? And how should America react?
Yeah, great question. Number one, Putin, I think this is something commonly misunderstood. And even it was, I want to be honest, it was misunderstood by me before I got to know Putin up close and personal. We in academia, for instance, tend to talk in realpolitik terms, right? Realism. Ronnie, you know this, you know, you know these guys well. You know, it's a balance of power and interests, and it doesn't really matter how states are organized internally. That is a very predominant theory in academia here in the United States. And I would say most foreign policymakers, Democrats and Republicans both, by the way, that's basically their worldview, right? Countries have interests and they stay basically the same, irrespective of whether Democrats or Republicans are in power, or irrespective of whether it's an autocracy or democracy. That's realpolitik. And for many, many years, I believe that Putin was a realist. And he kind of saw the world that way. In fact, Henry Kissinger and I have talked about this for many, many years. I now believe that that's wrong. I now believe that Putin is threatened by not American power, like, you know, the 82nd Airborne. He's not threatened by that. He's threatened by American ideas. He's threatened by democratic ideas. And he has become over time, you know, as you get older, you get more fixed in your views, right? And he's become, I most certainly have done that, I think, in my life. And he's older than me, and he's going to be more and more fixed in his views. And he believes that the United States is out to get him and is out to overthrow regimes that we don't like. And let's be honest. I want to be honest. There's, from time to time in American history, the United States government has helped to overthrow regimes. We have done that in our past. We did that in Serbia, for instance, in 2000. Let's be honest. We did that. We did overthrow Mossadegh in Iran in 1953. We did that. So we have a complicated history that gives Putin just enough evidence to say, well, this is what America does all the time. And to me, when there were demonstrations against Vladimir Putin back in 2011, 2012, massive demonstrations, right? Hundreds of thousands of people went onto the streets. He blamed the United States. He blamed Obama. He blamed Secretary Clinton. And he blamed me personally. He told me personally. He said, I know that you are here to foment a color revolution against me, and we are going to crush you. And I used to think that this was just blah, 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 and just electoral politics. But I think he's actually paranoid that way. And that's, sorry for my long answer, but that's the way you have to think, that through that prism, our battles with Putin in the Middle East with respect to Libya and Syria were through that prism, that he saw us as fomenting regime change in those places. And so his fundamental goal is to stop regime change in the Middle East. But that's his first goal. But his second goal is to be a realpolitik player and to improve relations with the Saudis, with the Israelis, with the Turks. And I think we need to acknowledge he's done that pretty well. I think he has reasserted Russia as a major kind of balance of power player in that region at the same time that the United States has been withdrawn.
There's a question on China. And in particular, the United States using the currency to weaponize it. against China in particular, but perhaps other people as well. How do you see that? Do you think it's possible?
Well, I did see that President Trump was joking about it a couple of days ago. I don't know if that was in your press. He was saying, if the Chinese are doing it, why shouldn't we do it? You know how he talks. I hope he was joking. I think it would be a disaster for my country. I can't speak for how it would affect Hong Kong or Beijing or Shanghai or the rest of the world. But I think we benefit tremendously from the power of our Federal Reserve to make pragmatic policy that benefits our economy and benefits the world. And in my grades that I said I gave grades to President Trump in my, I have a monthly column in the Washington Post, and I went through about 12 or 15 grades. One of the highest grades I gave to the Trump administration and to the United States government was on the global economy. I gave some pretty hard grades, a lot of D's and F's, but I gave them a C there because I do think Mr. Powell has performed rather well in a very difficult time for the global economy. And I think it would be a giant mistake to go down that path. I think that would be bad for the United States and bad for the global economy. I only gave him a C, however, because I'm quite disappointed in the lack of cooperation on how to handle the pandemic and how to handle the global economy. You know, we're going to have major differences with Beijing for many, many decades to come that no amount of talking is going to reconcile. But we also have overlaps in our common humanity on climate change, on the pandemic, and on the global economy. Those are three threats that are to the world. They're not contained within the borders of states. And I just think that with respect to the pandemic and with respect to the management of the global economy, those are two issues, you know, probably in the G20 is the right place to do it, but we have to find ways to look for win-win outcomes. And remember, I joined the government at the White House in January 2009, and I went to many G20 meetings and APEC meetings and all over the world, you know, where President Obama was disagreeing with the Russians and disagreeing with the Chinese on certain big issues, and at the same time was cooperating on these global issues where our mutual economic interests were at play. I remember, you know, in Pittsburgh at the G20 summit, we were all there together trying to get out of that last recession. That to me is something that I hope my country will someday return to, that global cooperation on economic, I think economic, climate, and health issues.
Because of the time we have to end here, I think, Mike, you've done a fantastic job. We have all learned a lot. I just tell everybody who is still on the line, if you are not a member of the Asia Society, you should join, because we have a lot of other questions. I tried to put in a lot of your questions in the last 25 minutes, but nonetheless, there's still more to come. You are welcome to join Asia Society. There are a lot of other programs that you can benefit from, as well as, you know, private discussions with important people such as Mike McFaul. So I want to thank you, Professor McFaul, for doing this. I think it's fantastic. Please stay on. Our members are still waiting for you. For the rest of you, join as a member of Asia Society, and you will be able to benefit. Thank you very much, Mike.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.